I had something in mind that I couldn't
When you were in Las Palmas, after you were married, you were at...
Oh, I worked for Everett Star weekends and during the summer.
And now you're 45.
Oh, yes. My mother died in 1925. And my father died, I can't say the year, do you know?
No, he died, I think it was 34.
I believe so.
March of 34.
Yeah.
I did.
I was here. Because the year after father died, I was on the final.
Yeah.
My kid was 15.
Dad died in 32. It would have been 33.
Mm-hmm.
March 33.
Yeah.
Okay, so you worked at Everett Store
during the summer.
So
two or three days.
That would have been what, in 1930?
It would have been in the 1930s.
And what year did you get married?
When was Tony born?
He was born in 35, and we got married in 70.
Oh, you said it was during the war. You were there during the war.
Mm-hmm.
And you lived in the cabin.
Mm-hmm. Later on,
just
I moved
you,
to...
Just you and your husband?
Uh-huh. And later on, we moved to what we call High House, which is up the hill. On that same property.
Oh, okay.
I was in Roscommon. I took piano lessons. And one time, Mary Lockery was the teacher. And Edith Hammond was taking piano lessons too. And one time, we had a recital. And Edith and I played a duet.
Now, was this when you were a child?
No, after you were married.
Oh, how fun.
Yeah.
And where did you go for these lessons?
Mary came to our houses.
Oh, she had a piano in your home.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I have a piano in my home that Esther brought up to Grass Common, to Bay City. It was called an apartment-sized piano.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the full size, but it wasn't upright. And we moved that to Roscommon. Oh no, we moved it from Roscommon here, didn't we? Esther moved it to Roscommon on top of her car. She was like my father. She could manage things like that. And then we moved the piano down here.
When did you first have a car?
Well, our family didn't have a car till Everett got the Nash.
When?
In 29. It was raining when we started the date. Before that time, we had horses sometimes. I remember one time when I was 8 or 9, we had a horse named Flora. My father used a rig, you see, to go out around the county selling his machinery. And my father led her down to the creek to drink. And he didn't tell me. I didn't know that she would lower her head, that it would be so far down, but she lowered her head and I went head over heels into the creek off Florida. Sometimes my father had sheep that he would hold in a kind of a fold in Ross Cabin that I guess they were taking out to Nile. And I remember going at night with him to, I guess, to feed the sheep. We had to feed them during the winter in the pasture.
Who were some of your childhood friends that you remember from that time?
Well, Ruth Wallace and I were sort of rivals. She was very smart and very good in school. And she had curls and I had curls. But my curls were a little tighter than hers. And she said, well, if her hair was like a horse's tail, her curls would be tight too. And in high school, my best friend was Zelma Mead of the Mead family. And there are many of them still in that family. And I heard from Zelma until 2 years ago. And I guess she's not able to write anymore. So I haven't heard anything from her for about 2 years. As far as I know, she still lives, because I think her obituary would be sent to Ross Common, for sure.
We should get back to when you were living in Ross Common during the war. How did the war affect what you did?
Well, gas was rationed and sugar was rationed.
Was it rationed what you received at the store, and did you have to do a ration to your customers?
They had to present tickets, I think.
Yes, they had tickets.
Or sugar and whatever else.
And butters. But when you went to your wholesaler, were you only allowed to get so much off them?
Yes.
I forget what would be rationed for the wholesalers. My Pam was a grocery salesman, and he made quite a killing on sardines. This was in World War II. I used to go with him on some of the trips. And there was a fine old English gentleman who had a store in Auglay. And Pam told him he'd better order up a lot of sardines because the Germans were dynamiting the ocean and killing off the sardines. Some ham sold more sardines than we've ever sold before, all over the territory.
The war helped him a little bit.
We didn't really suffer any privation.
Did you do volunteer work? I remember there's a picture of. Oh, I know someone donated to the Cross Society a bunch of bandages that they were wrapped by women.
I didn't do any of that. I never seemed to have time for volunteer work.
I remember that he was coming from the first aid course, which we took, and then Ed Stewart taught us all how to knit, and we did it for the war. I made it better than 82.
Speaking of knitting, I was thinking the other day of Agnes's son Tony, who learned how to knit. And he was knitting a long string that's going to be underwear for Victor Jacobson, who lived across the road.
So you stayed in Roscommon through the war years and all?
We moved down here in 1944.
Oh, during the war, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And why did you move here then?
No, I don't know what reason, except probably Dan wanted to get back to his hometown.
Mm-hmm.
And we bought this house. And we were renting that home. We were renting from Esther.
So when you were in Roscommon those 10 years, was Esther living there also, or was she in Chicago?
No, she was in Chicago. She came back to Roscommon, I believe, in 55 or so, wasn't it? I think so.
Yeah,
somewhere along the way.
And Mel and George were already here in Big City when you were in Roscommon?
No. Mel was working in Everett's store.
Oh, yeah.
And when she and George were married, they were married in Spokane. And then George went on his second shift in the Army, went to New Guinea. Then Mel lived with us here and worked in the library here.
Oh.
And then when Mel came back, she and George lived in Roscommon. In the meantime, Mel had had a house started in Roscommon on the river. And George always said if he'd known she didn't have a garage built, they wouldn't have gotten married.
Is that house still there?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
House that Anne Foy lives in.
Oh, okay. connection with Goss Common after 1944 was to visit.
To visit. Mm-hmm. Very pleasant visits. And of course, there were great changes in Goss Common. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember the first time we had an electric iron. Up to that time, we'd been ironing with the old sad irons, they called them, that you heated on the stove. Uh-huh. And Mrs. Hall at the hotel was a very nice lady. And Zelma worked for her board at the hotel, going to high school. And Mrs. Hall was getting a new iron, I don't know why. And she was selling the one they'd been using. And I came home and told my mother that Mrs. Hall was going to sell her electric iron and couldn't we have it. And so I suppose they went into a huddle, mother and dad, decided they could afford the electric iron. And I went up and got it. And from then on, we were going to town with electricity.
Do you remember, that was something else I wanted to ask about, was when you first had electricity there?
I don't remember.
Remember that in the history of the Gamma House, we talk about the village having generated their own electricity for some time.
I wouldn't be surprised, and that was William Wallace, who was the engineer who took care of the water plant and the electric plant.
So you remember in your early years, which would have been, you came to us from the 07 and 18 years, you were doing the kerosene light.
Mm-hmm.
So you didn't have electricity then?
Oh, no. I'd say we didn't have electricity till maybe not too far World War II. I'm not sure.
Oh, no, we had it long before then.
Would we?
Mm-hmm.
When do you think?
Well, I don't know.
They generated their own for a while.
Mr. Wallace used to run it. And they shut it down at 10 o'clock and get the signal. And they shut it off at 10:30. Generally. Mm-hmm. But some kind of a signal we give them, point to the light show. So we don't even know if they were higher than what I did. Then they had a half hour.
To wrap things up. Now, when you lived at the cabin, then did you have electricity there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The whole town was wired by then. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things I remember is cooking cornmeal mush for breakfast. We had a great big black iron kettle with three little tiny nubs on the bottom. And at that time, we had a real cook stove that you burn wood in. And you'd set that kettle, you could set it, take the lid out and set the kettle down into, right next to the fire. And oh my, it would get nice and black and sooty. And was it miserable to wash. The cornmeal, you'd clean it out as well as you could, and it would be dried on the inside. And it was a heavy thing to handle. It was a miserable thing. But we just loved the cornmeal mush for breakfast. And then we always made enough to put into a black dip pan and let it cool. And then at night we had fried cornmeal mush for supper. And it was that delicious. Those who wanted it could put syrup on it, but otherwise you could just eat it. Well, George and I were talking about that the other day, about what good food that was. How delicious.
Did you like to cook? Did your mother cook you?
Oh, I had to do quite a bit of it. But I'm not a good cook.
And the baking, you said your mother baked
bread? Mother baked bread, but that went on for only 2 or 3 years, just to get the customers coming in. Mm-hmm. And after a while, we got rid of the big old cook stove and got an oil stove. Oh my, were they nasty things. They smelled so. Mm-hmm. You could always tell when people had an oil stove to use, the place smelled of of kerosene oil. And that was an advantage.
It wasn't really good.
No, it was very slow.
Took us from 8 in the morning to 6 at night to fry the roast of turkey, and then we cut it all up and fry it.
So they were probably short-lived before the gas came.
And then we put a roof frame.
Went back to the wood burning. And the nice thing about the wood burning stove was the reservoir, where you could have hot water. And then the warming of them, too. In those cold winters, if you got a batch of pancakes ready, you could always set them up there and they'd keep warm till at least you were down to the table. So that was a nice arrangement.
Well, it sounds like you had quite a nice childhood in our town.
Oh, yes.
Good education.
Yes, we had a real good education because we got new, young, enthusiastic, well-trained teachers.
And the classes were small.
Pardon?
And the classes were small.
Oh, yes. That was another point that was real advantage over the large schools today.
Did you go out to Higgin Place very much?
Well, after we got that bicycle at Darwin sent, Nell and I, and I think maybe Everett, went on a trip to Higgins Lake, and it was only about 5 miles up the nearest point, you know. And one would ride the bicycle about a mile and drop it and start walking, and the rest would catch up. And another one would ride the bike past everybody, drop the bike and walk on. That's where we got moving going.
Great.
And then Mother told about when we first came to Roscommon, we had a carriage or hired a carriage, I don't know which, and went to Higgins Lake. And Everett and I had never seen a lake, and we kept asking every puddle we went by or ditch, is this the lake? Is this the lake? Finally got there. But in the summers, we were always so busy. We had the store, and that was when all the people came to town. And we didn't have much time, except Sundays, and didn't have much transportation for a while.
You weren't going swimming at the lake every day. You probably
no.
went in the river.
Oh, did we have fun on the river?
Oh, tell us about that.
Oh, Mark's Marsh. And there are marshes still in Roscommon. He had a brother, Jake, who had a livery stable. And his daughter, Alice, is one of the two business women that I remember. There were two women I remember that went to work every day. Alice Marsh, and she would stop at the post office, which was in that building that was Esther's. And that's where the post office was. She'd pick up the mail for the courthouse. And then she walked diagonally across the intersection, the main intersection, and down to the courthouse.
What, you remember what her job was?
Well, she was with the Register of Deeds, I believe.
Wasn't she county treasurer?
County clerk.
Okay.
Did she hold the office?
Yes.
Oh. The other person was Salome Shepherd. Her name was Salome Thorbush. And she came to Roscommon as a office person for Charlie Blanchard, who had the lumbering business. And she always looked neat and trig and trim. And she would be downtown. I suppose she picked up the mail too. So those women were there. And Alice Marsh always carried an umbrella. She was always ready for rain. And Mark Marsh was right on the river. In fact, it's on his property that Adams lives now. He owns all that property. And he had a boat, a river boat, and it was tied up there. And we kids used to go down and just help ourselves to the boat. And I guess he must have had poles in it. And we'd pull up river and ride down. And we had a lot of fun in the summer with that riverboat.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't do much swimming. There was a swimming hole where the boys lived. And girls would go once in a while. But I never did care about swimming unless it was too hot to be anywhere else. I didn't want to get my hair all wet and sandy and so on. So I wasn't much of a swimmer.
Well, is there anything else that you think you
should
know about?
Oh dear me, yeah.
We'll think of some more
if you want to
add to it.
I think the things may go through my head
out again. Yeah, well, I think you've done very well. You're a nice remember.
Yeah.
It was a good life.
Yeah, okay,
we'll end our
speech
for now.
Okay. I imagine George will be anxious to go to lunch.
Now we've had lunch, and we're going to do a couple more things for a wrap-up.
Mm-hmm. Well, we went to the Methodist Church, and I remember Jim Cornelius' old grandfather coming to an evening meeting carrying a lantern, and he was in a long brown overcoat, and he had a very quite long beard. He was a very distinguished-looking old gentleman, and he had been a minister and was coming to church. And that's where Everett prayed for rain and cried because the storm was so terrible. And Mother said, well, Everett, didn't you pray for rain? He said, yes, I prayed for rain, but I didn't pray for such a storm as this. And we went to Sunday school. We often got the young ministers from England. And I remember one came who taught us English carols, to sing English carols.
You know, this was a Methodist church?
Mm-hmm.
Where in Roscommon was it?
The Methodist church is still in existence there, and it's the Masonic Temple now.
Okay, so that was before it was a school.
That was before it was a school.
Okay, and that's what you're talking about.
Uh-huh.
Then when it became a school, where did that congregation go?
The congregational church.
Mm-hmm. Or they used the congregational church.
No, they became congregation.
They changed the Methodist to congregation.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Mother was superintendent of the Sunday school a lot of the time, and we children liked it because the papers, the Sunday school papers and the cards, the picture cards, came in on either Friday or Saturday. And we had a chance to see them before they were taken to church on Sunday.
So you had a sneak preview ahead of
And I remember one story. I don't remember the plot or anything, but it ended up with a little boy, after an earthquake, being caught and held in the basement for quite a while. And the only thing that he had to live on, I thought, was heavenly. And it was a big pile of oranges that were in the basement. That's what he had to subsist on. I couldn't think of anything nicer than to be in the basement with a great big pile of oranges. And we always had a Christmas tree and our exercises in which the children practiced and performed on during the Christmas holiday for the church, learned our pieces and sang our songs. And
how large was the congregation? How many people?
Oh dear me! I really wouldn't have any idea. I suppose in church it would have been maybe 40 or 50 on a Sunday. See, there were several Protestant churches in the area, and that would diminish the crowd in each church. And when we had an organ for music.
Do you remember who played it?
Pardon?
Do you remember who played it?
I don't remember who played it when I was a child. I remember Mrs. J. Burt Kiley sang, and she'd been trained. She'd been in Ohio at some music school. It could have been Oberlin. And of course we all thought her cultivated singing voice was very peculiar and very funny. And she's the one I took music lessons from. And lots to go to her house because J. Bert Cotty, her husband, had quite a library. Read many books. Many of them were the Zane Grey books, and we were allowed to take those home and read them.
Where did they live?
They lived in the same location as where Margaret DeRail's house in town was, on the little creek, Tank Creek. Or was it Robinson Creek?
Well,
I've forgotten which it was.
It's Robinson Creek.
Robinson Creek. Well, that's where their house was. And of course, it's been torn down a long time. Pardon me?
Would be where Margaret
DeWale's
house was.
Yes, where Margaret DeWale's house was. Mm-hmm. And we had the visiting superintendent came, and I believe his headquarters were in Grand Rapids. And the congregational district superintendent came from Detroit. But anyway, whenever they came, Mother always had them come to dinner. I think she liked to have us children meet with the more educated and people like that that came to town. She liked to have us in their company. And we went to church every Sunday, went to prayer meeting on Wednesday night. And as we grew older, the Methodists had for young people what was called an Epworth League. And when we became a member of the Congregational Church, they had Christian Endeavor. And those were meetings for young people, and we got up and led the meeting. And we had parties, and we had sleigh rides, and trying to keep us interested in church affairs.
So the church was quite a major part of your family?
Oh yes, it meant a great deal to us. It was very precious to us. And now should we go to the Marsh sisters?
Yeah, about the Marsh family.
Well, the Marsh family were quite extensive. There was what we called Old Marks Marsh. His wife had been dead for some time, I believe. And he owned property on the river and on the little creek that runs into the river. And his house was there, and the house of the Olivers. That was his daughter, Mabel, and her two children. I never saw her first husband. Maybe he didn't exist, I don't know. But anyway, purportedly the name was Oliver. And Leona and Florence were enchanting girls because they were always telling wonderful stories about trash heaps with dolls in them and all kinds of wonderful things you could find.
They were Mabel's daughters.
They were her daughters, and they were in school.
She was the Marsh girl.
She was a Marsh girl, sister of Alice Marsh.
And those two girls were the
granddaughters.
They were supposed to be the first two white babies born
in that
town.
So?
No, in the village. Around the village.
Anyway, all the Marsh family had the most beautiful brown eyes, all of them. Keith and Marks. Then there was old Jake Marsh. He was Mark Marsh's brother, who had a livery stable. And
Keith and Jake were
Marks and Jake were the old generation. Then came Norm Marsh. And Alice and Mabel, those three, were in the second family. And then in the third family were Florence and Leona and Norma and Keith.
Norma and Keith were daughters of Norma.
Norma was a girl and Keith was a son. Okay. They were in the third generation, you see. And Mr. Marsh was a very gentle, kind old man, and he always had a riverboat. I suppose he fished from it. And he left it tied to a branch of a tree on the river. And our family, kids, used to go down to the river and help ourselves to the boat. And there was a pole and we'd pull upstream. And if we were coming up, we'd have to shout for the boys to get out of the swimming hole because we were coming through. They were all bare naked. They didn't own a swimming suit between them. And we'd go up river as far as we had strength for, probably. Esther was the two of us. And then we'd float down, and we'd put Mr. Marsh's boat where we found it, and leave the poles in it, and lead it there till the next time when we'd go. And he never said a word to us. I don't think we ever saw him. We just helped ourselves.
What did he do for a living?
Gosh, I don't know what he did.
And his son, Norman, what did he do for a living?
Well, in later years, he was a real estate man. He sold real estate in Ross County.
Did he stay there? He lived there all the time?
Oh, yes. His wife's name was Carrie. They had two children, Norman and Keith. And they lived up on the hill where the Congregational Church is now. Not in the house that was next to the church, but in the second house from the church where they lived.
Fordstown.
Fordstown. And then the next place was, I think it's still there, it's kind of an apartment house. That's before you get to the hotel. And that belonged to Aunt Anna Kiley, the woman who had the grocery store down the corner. And I don't think she ever had anybody living with her, but Mike Gibbons was her son-in-law. I don't know whether he was her son-in-law or nephew. And his wife's name was Vern. Have you had them talked about in your history at all? Mike Gibbons was postmaster for a long time.
Was his wife one of the original Blanchard girls?
No, they might have been. She might have been. I believe she was.
Mr. Blanchard had children by his first wife before he had Noni.
Had women.
Had
women. Oh, Bud. Have they told you about him? Are you all
well,
of that?
Well, Bud I met, the younger Bud I met. No, I didn't either. I met his son.
I didn't even know he had a son.
He was the same one.
No, Bud was
see,
the other married.
There were two. Then he must be from the first of his
family.
Must
have been.
Married,
I believe so.
He had two families.
And Bud Blanchard was a very amiable, kind of witty person, and was a drunkard, an alcoholic, I should say. And he always had a little bottle of whiskey. When he was on a dry spell, he still had that little bottle of whiskey with him in case of need, I guess. And he was amiable and friendly. Didn't he used to work a little bit for Everett?
Everett kind of took him under his wing, hoping he could sober him up and make him feel useful. And, you know, and I remember he gave him Everett's jackets to wear.
Uh-huh.
And he had spells and he was really good.
Uh-huh.
And then he was kind of off, but didn't he
fall off the wagon?
Mm-hmm. I think that's where he got it.
Well, I think of it. They had quite a strong WCTU in Ross County. Do you know what that was? You do? Mm-hmm. Women's Christian Temperance Union.
Oh.
And people signed a pledge not to drink.
Uh-huh.
I remember Kenneth signed. Kenneth, our oldest brother, signed the pledge not to drink, and I don't think he ever did. And at the time, I think there were at that time three saloons in town: Daphne and Breathman and Duale. And of course, at one time they say there were 21 saloons in Ross County. And I remember going past the saloon, and they all had swinging doors, you know, and peeking under the door, wondering what went on in there. We knew it was a wicked place. And we knew that all the saloon keepers' families lived very well and had very nice clothes. They had the best of everything because they made money off the misery of Idaho people. There were quite a few drugs to be seen in Ross County at that time. Well, and speaking of the Methodist Church, they used to have revival meetings once a year, and ministers would come from outside and hold meetings every night of the week that they were there. And across the road from us, when we were living across next to railroad track, was a family called Charlie and Sarah Williams. Has anybody mentioned them to you? He was a shoemaker. He was a shoemaker and a Welshman, and she always had a beautiful garden, old-fashioned flowers, just lovely. And they were both, I don't think Charlie was a drinker, but she was. I remember seeing her out on the street with her black hair streaming down her back, screaming and yelling at some man that I guess was rooming at their house. He was drunk. Well, anyway, when the Methodist ministers were there, they went to call on her and Charlie. And that was a real conversion, because they reformed, absolutely, changed their lives. Sarah could read and Charlie couldn't. And she would read the Bay City paper to him every night, sitting on their porch. And she would read from the Bible and from the hymn book to him. And she went to church every Sunday. And since she was reformed and a Christian now, she made herself free to kiss my mother. And mother bore it with Christian fortitude. It wasn't her choice, but she put up with it. Well, anyway, that was a real change in life for those two. And Mrs. Williams had a great big loom in her kitchen. And she wove cotton rugs of rag. And I can remember hearing that treadle that she worked with her feet, and the shovel, and the packing of the machinery as she used it. And she sold quite a lot of rugging, I suppose, to people at the lake. We used her homemade carpeting. They were very interesting people.
Let's go back a little bit to the two Marsh sisters that were sisters of
Norton.
Tell us what Alice was the one that worked in the
church. Alice, every weekday morning, about 8 o'clock, would come downtown from the river where they lived, come downtown, go to the post office.
They lived in the house that's located where
It's the house that Carpenter, Frank Carpenter, lives in.
Not at that time. It's where Dan Fisher lives now. Mabel Howard's house was the house next to mine. We were talking about this morning. It was the next one from this, Mary's house. Mm-hmm. That's where Mabel Howard lives. And then Alice lives in the house where Frank Carpenter lives. And that's where Dan Fisher lives now.
Oh, okay. And then which Marsh owned the property that you bought?
Well, Alice, I don't know which Marsh.
Alice lived there.
But Alice had the house built, the original house built, in 1936. And we bought that after she died.
Mm-hmm.
We bought it in
1936.
It was the second
house for
her? Well,
that was the only house she built in. The second house she lived in on the river.
Oh, I see. She lived with her father.
Yeah, mm-hmm. She lived with her father. She was a spinster all her life.
She was a spinster, but she wasn't unloved.
No, she wasn't. Ray Hoopley.
No, Ralph.
Ralph.
Oh, shoot. What was his last name?
His mother was the lady down the railroad track.
His mother was Mrs. Hall of the hotel.
Oh, was she?
Mm-hmm.
Miss Boston.
No.
Who was Ray Hoopley?
Oh, poor Ray Rupley was a pitiful creature. A good fellow. I don't think he ever did a wrong thing in his life. But he had a kind of a falsetto voice. And he yearned to be with good people and the right people, but he was just peculiar. And his mother, of course, hadn't had a good name. They tell a story about her once. She was coming off of the post office, and Ori Billman was in town, and he was calling his dog, and he said, "Here's Bart, here's Bart." She turned around and said, "Well, I used to be, but I ain't anymore." You know, Roscommon was full of stories of this fancy and that. That was that story we still tell.
Sounds like something Kate.
Yeah. And Alice was a very competent, able person. Everybody liked her. Very pleasant.
And she never married.
She never married. But she had this this lover. And at the end, she had another big... What was his last...
He was the one that had a hardware store.
No, that's Ralph.
And that's what I thought. Ralph who?
I can't think of his last name now. He was Mrs. Hall's son. And the last lover she had was a kind of a carpenter. His name was Babe something.
Babe Miller.
Babe Miller.
He worked on the railroad.
Oh, well, that's the last...
The one committed suicide
was
the balance. And that was Ralph.
That was Ralph. Uh-huh.
And he wanted to marry her, and I guess they weren't engaged.
Oh, did he want to marry her? Oh, I didn't know that. And Mabel earned money for herself and her girls. I never saw Mr. Oliver, whether he was real or a figment of the imagination. I don't know. But anyway, the girls were named Oliver, Florence and Leona Oliver. And Mrs. Oliver worked the railroad towns up and down selling clothing out of a piece of luggage that used to be called
Paris?
No.
What did you call it?
I told you that.
Telescope.
And it was like a box, the bottom and the top that fitted over it, and then there were straps that held it together with a handle. And she used the Michigan Central to go up to Grayling and go to Gaylord. I don't know what her routine was of how she went, but that's how she earned legal money.
She sold clothes that she made?
Pardon me?
She sold clothes that she made?
No. She had some connection or other.
She wholesaled it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, she retailed it.
Well, she retailed it.
Yeah. She sold it to people. Mm-hmm. And then after some years, she married this Jeff Powell. And he was an amateur painter. I don't know what else he did. They had a chicken farm out on Old 27 going north of Grayling. And he did a lot of painting of pictures, and I suppose that there are a good many of his pictures in the county somewhere. Mm-hmm. They were very crudely painted things.
Primitive?
Yes, you'd call them primitive. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. I have one of them.
Uh-huh. They were usually deer.
Yeah, that's what mine is.
And forest. And maybe some partridge and things like that.
Did he make somewhat of a living selling paintings?
I don't know. I don't know. I think he did it on the side. Mm-hmm. I think he liked to paint, and if somebody offered him some money, I think he'd take it. As far as I know, he never made much of a business out of it. And then another businesswoman that I knew was Salome Shepherd. Her name was Salome Farbush, and she came from Frederick, I believe, to work as a stenographer for Charlie Blanchard. And then I think she worked for Lorac after Charlie gave up the business. And then she married Clarence Shepherd, Duck Shepherd.
She worked with him.
She did. She was a bookkeeper for their business, their automobile business. And Dutch had a brother named Harold Murphy, he never married. And Bob Murphy, the father of Harold, was a very amiable, very pleasant person. And he used to often come in the store, especially at election time. He'd come in and buy boxes of those covered cherry chocolate candy with a little liquor inside, you know. He'd buy a dozen of those at a time and go around the county electioneering with them. Sometimes when I was working in the store, he'd come in and we used to have cakes of honey at that time to sell. You don't see them very often anymore. I think it's more, they're more scarce. But they were square collections of bells filled with honey. And he'd say, have you any cake, honey?
he was a sheriff for many years.
Yes, he was electioneering first to be sheriff. And the family lived in the courthouse. Does that still exist? That house on the hill, mm-hmm. It's gone.
What you've been mourning about, they tore down their courthouse.
Oh.
Even the hill has been.
You see, there was a courthouse separate, and then the sheriff's family, and of course they fed the prisoners in that house. And I guess that's all I can think of.
Well, that was very good. Very interesting.
You're a good interlocutor.
Well, thank you very much, Vi. And I want to also say that our other interviewer here, contributor, is Agnes Wagner.
Oh.
You have your voice.
Wait, did he?
Well, thank you very much. It was very nice, Vi.
Well, it's been kind of fun to do it. And I was